7 gold chains on me, call me Slick Rick. Just made an album, 7 days, that's quick. Boobies going up and down, she's fit. Hold up, wait, rewind that shit. Got uncut gems, Adam Sandler clip. She a vegan, she got a thigh gap. Get my BL smell good, it smell like lilac. My team eating, yeah, we did a lot. I'm a cash rat, always do a buyback. Down payment on the whole metropolis. I'm a healthy serial monogamous. She a turkey on my dick, she gobble it. Big dick appointment, gynecologist.
Have you ever been playing a game, having the time of your life, and all of a sudden you encounter a hacker floating above you, promptly killing you with a glance? Or maybe you've engaged in grinding a game with an economy, and found the prices of items more inflated than a DeviantArt Yoshi because of botting or item duplication. You yourself may have even discovered a bug in a game that gives you an advantage, exploiting it to the chagrin of your friends and opponents. And yeah, it's fun for a little while, but inevitably you cause yourself and others to burn out on the game faster. On the darker side of this topic, there are so-called bot mafias that profit millions of dollars from this behavior. They've been known to dox or threaten the lives of individuals who speak out about them. And all of this before we even mention the topic of exploits that go beyond the game, crashing your computer or taking it over completely. Today, we're covering the myriad vulnerabilities that we found in the top itch.io game at the time. We have some incredibly entertaining footage here, so stick around and find out how we did it. Our organization has a vast swath of skill sets, ranging from web to binary exploitation to reverse engineering, but, you know, what truly makes a hacker is creativity. One area where we had only really dipped our toes was game hacking. While we have found vulns in games you've heard of, like Duolingo, and a few you probably haven't, like Capsule Wars and Co-op Catacombs, none of those were extensive hunts. Our selection process was very simple. We went to itch.io, searched for multiplayer games, and picked the most popular one. At the time, this was the multiplayer bow and arrow arena shooter known as narrow.one. There were so many factors that made this game ideal for us. Firstly, it was a game running entirely in the browser, meaning we weren't required to decompile a binary, which can be a tedious and inconsistent process. We could instead simply inspect the game's client-side JavaScript. Secondly, the client communicated with the servers via a custom WebSocket protocol. This was new to us, but nonetheless, we were able to reverse engineer it, learning a lot about it in the process. Most importantly, the game itself was just a vibe. Plenty of us had hours of playing it without doing any sort of hacking, just for the excitement of turning our enemies into pincushions. And so, we dove headfirst. Presented with such an expansive attack surface, we sank our teeth into what we were familiar with. APIs, authentication systems, and concurrency. I see London, I see France, your girl in her underpants. She said I'm a better man. We first identified that the game has a shop. We also found that the backend uses concurrency. Race conditions are very common in this context, as concurrency is very rarely done perfectly. This was not one of those rare cases, and indeed, we identified our first vulnerability of the hunt, which has been given the tongue-in-cheek moniker of loan sharking. By completing objectives and killing enemies, players can earn an in-game currency, which can be used to buy cosmetic upgrades for weapons and armor. Thing is, those cosmetic upgrades aren't so cosmetic. They provide buffs to damage, resistances, attack speed, health regeneration, you name it. To demonstrate what's so exotic about loan sharking that it deserves its own name, imagine a traditional limit overrun attack on a shop, where an attacker sends 10 requests to buy an item, all at once. The code running the shop has 10 threads processing all those requests at the same time, in parallel. Each thread checks that the buyer has enough currency to buy that item, then sets the balance of the player's account to their balance minus item cost. By doing this, an attacker would be able to purchase 10 items for the price of one. Instead, with loan sharking, the shop properly charges you for all the items you have bought, but it does it after selling you the items. In practice, this means you can collect 100 gold and buy 10 items worth 100 gold each at exactly the same time. You know what that means. I see London, I see France, your girl in her underpants. She said I'm a better man, had a nice place, get intense. Type out money, call me Benz. That's right. Crippling debt. Now that we owe an amount of coins equivalent to the GDP of Yemen, we have to deal with our problems like adults, by ignoring them and focusing on something else. Funny enough, this next thing that we found was actually the main vulnerability that the developers paid us out for. We identified that the game's user profiles can be edited and linked to external accounts via Oauth. Cross-site request forgery is a vuln class ubiquitous in systems like this. If you've seen our first video, you may be familiar with the concept of cross-site request forgery. In essence, if some action, say changing a password, can be made on an account with a generic request, an attacker can craft a malicious request and trick a user into running it, in many cases just by clicking a link. Now, a common mitigation for this is to make the request unique. This is done by including a type of state token, usually referred to as a CSRF token. If the CSRF token attached to a request doesn't match what the server expects, the request is denied. In the context of Oauth, typically the site employing it will generate said token and store it in the user's browser. The most common way of identifying cross-site request forgery is static analysis. Simply inspect the content of the request, and if it lacks the state token, it likely lacks the mitigation as well and can be forged. In the case of narrow.one, a state token existed but was never ultimately validated, which we discovered after sending a fake token and getting a successful response. The actual impact of this exploit boils down to account takeover, or ATO, via forced Oauth account linking. If you've ever had a social media or news website ask you to sign in with Google or Discord, you've encountered this process. In our case, the intended functionality of the Oauth flow is to link accounts, owned by the same user, to allow for one-click logins. However, our CSRF exploit forces users to link their accounts to an attacker's, resulting in a one-click account takeover. If I asked you to tell me what the text scrolling on screen means, do you think you could figure it out?
You say you love me, but you just wanna be friends with me. You say you love me, but your work took all your energy.
How about now?
You never listen when I just need an apology.
Perhaps you may begin to notice that some bytes don't change. Like the first byte, it always seems to be a 1. Maybe you take it a step further and compare the packets to the screen, frame by frame, and see how the changes to the string affect the ball. This is exactly the kind of mystery we were presented with, only orders of magnitude, more data and more complexity. Either for a personal challenge or just a lack of a better approach, we analyzed the stream of WebSocket data in much the same way. Because packets regularly began with the same values, we made the assumption that these function like opcodes, denoting the action for the client or server to take when. By repeatedly performing some action, we can see that the volume of a specific opcode increases in the packet stream, confirming this. Once we know the action associated with the first byte, we can start figuring out the rest of the data with that opcode by making very slight changes to our inputs. For example, the O3 packet is sent to the server whenever the client fires a weapon. By firing the weapon once, moving the player one step, and firing again, we see that only a specific section of the packet changes, and we can infer that this section of the packet transmits the position of the player. Rinse and repeat several thousand times, and we have successfully documented a large enough part of their WebSocket protocol to forge our own packets. A naive example of this is to simply replay the O9 packets, which were mapped to the death score update function, and watch as our teammates grow from rage to genuine concern over our well-being. Of course, we don't intend to spend a cumulative 100 man hours documenting this process for something so mundane. Instead, we set our sights on a bigger prize. By analyzing the sequence of packets sent and received when connecting to a game, we can create connections to the game from a Python script to connect hundreds of puppets controlled by us to a server at once. Ironically, we aren't able to amass an army of thousands of bots to show you because the server simply couldn't handle that many simultaneous connections. The impact of attempting this, however, is knocking the server offline for the duration of the connection and anyone on it. With this alone, we could hypothetically knock the entire game offline, permanently, by enumerating the servers the game has via the matchmaking service and force connecting to all the servers constantly. Ultimately, our research here culminates in us having the ability to not just connect the bots to the servers, but to physically spawn them and move them around the map. We took this as far as creating a proof of concept script that will spawn a small horde of bots and follow a target player. But there is no doubt in our minds that if we had the incentive, we could have made bots to auto-kill enemies and grab the flag and make the game effectively unwinnable. Of course, at this point, we're more just flexing our skills than contributing anything to the report, as the devs simply don't have the resources to properly mitigate this kind of player impersonation. With that, we'll get to the really entertaining stuff. But keep in mind that all of the cheats we're about to cover can hypothetically be applied to an autonomous army of bots doing our bidding. Next up, we began to dig into the client-side JavaScript. Upon doing so, one of the first things we saw was a dictionary mapping action names to opcodes. We essentially started looking for diamonds in the sewer before looking in any jewelry shops, and while this was certainly an oversight, it might have been for the best. We learned a massive amount about how the server was validating actions, and likely never would have found the DOS if we didn't start there. After overcoming the misery of this realization, we identified the object that stores the game. This allows us to call game functions and modify arbitrary properties of ourselves, other players, or even the game itself. If there is a lack of server-side validation for the modified properties or resulting attributes, say speed and position, players can get an unfair advantage. Some variation of this concept is the key behind almost all hacking and cheating in online games. The data sent to the server is manipulated via direct client modification, memory injection, packet manipulation, or something of the sort. This altered data is processed as though it's legitimate, and now you're zooming around the sky at light speed. In the case of narrow.one, this was very easily achieved. Not only is walk speed a player attribute we can modify, but the game has flight built in for spectators. We can enable it during play by simply setting a flag. While we didn't need to, we also implemented flight ourselves by clobbering the allow can jump function, such that it always returns true. We did this because it allows us to easily switch between parkour and flight, and because more frequent landing and less consecutive airtime lowers the risk of being kicked. Additionally, we were able to achieve a hang glider-like effect by reducing the intensity of gravity on the player. There was no point to this, we just did it because we could. We were able to scale walls via manipulation of the needs ladder physics function, and walk through them via toppling the no-clip boolean. We could walk into the enemy spawn by editing our team ID, and we could teleport to our own, still holding the enemy flag, by calling respawn without dying. Speaking of not dying, setting our health to be a constant value granted us immortality. It goes without saying that this is just about the biggest advantage possible in a combat-based game, and an endlessly frustrating one to be faced with. We can also modify certain properties of other players, at least as far as our own client is concerned. One impact we can achieve is by removing opponents' melee weapons. There isn't much need, considering immortality is trivial, but your enemy trying to stab you with nothing, like a vengeful mime, is quite a sight to behold. We can modify properties of our own weapons, making crossbows rapid fire, or scout bows shoot an arbitrary amount of arrows at once. A high enough simultaneous arrow count will crash the server, the browser, and occasionally even the computer of the other players as it attempts to render them. The hacks we could have made here are endless. If you can imagine it, it can be done. Ultimately, we submitted our report and were delighted to find that the devs both responded promptly and found the information worthy of a bounty payout. If you enjoyed this, come check out our Discord server. Stay vigilant, and we'll see you next time.